on your identity. I think Snapchat is probably a good example of an identity company because they're really focusing on digital avatars and finding ways to express your identity in different ways. So I think we're going to see that a lot more within virtual reality as well as in augmented reality. And then the other end is a little bit more empathy and partnership, and that tends to be, you know, the other, which means that a lot of narrative or storytelling experiences, I think, kind of fit into that, where you start to not be, like, I think there's a little bit of a tension that if you look at, you know, self and other, this is something where either you are really fully present in your own experience, or you are listening to somebody else's experience. And I think that this is kind of the crux of a lot of narrative and storytelling in video games and VR, is this paradox of, are you really being present in your own experience, or are you actually listening to someone else's story and their experience? And Ubisoft has different ways of describing it. They kind of talk about the player's story, and your story as you're going through a game, or the protagonist's story, which is the story of what's happening within the experience. But I think this is a tension that presence is something that I'll be talking a little bit more. And sometimes talking to different people like Eric Darnell from Baobab Studios, he says that there's actually a trade-off between empathy and interactivity. And I think it gets to this, what he's saying here, is that when you're present in your own identity, you're really focusing on your interactivity. How can I insert my will into this experience? And you start to think about, like, what are the bounds of my will or power that I can exert? What are the rules? What can I change? And then it becomes a little bit less receptive of what the story's been that's being presented to you. And so it's a little bit of a context switch. And, you know, I think video game industry has different ways of dealing with that, whether it's like through kind of cinematic cutaways or some ways they kind of blend it together in certain experiences. But I think that in empathy and partnership, I'll be talking about the different dimensions of presence a little bit more, kind of my way that I think about it. But in the storytelling, you can almost say that I would make the argument that in some ways the best headset for delivering a story might be the Gear VR. It's a mobile headset where you don't have the ability to actually express yourself in a way. It's kind of really limiting your own agency and your own sense of presence, and it's really focusing you on being present for the story that's being told. So I think that Google and Samsung, as well as AMD, they're really focusing a lot of their initiatives on, you know, platforms that are going to enable storytelling within a little bit more, less interactive mediums. And I think that's part of the reason that's why Samsung's putting so much money in the film industry, why they're sponsoring Sundance. It's why AMD's a little different because they sort of span both, but they're really focusing on how to push forward this storytelling. But just go back to this for a minute, just see if there's any other thing. I think social and community is a huge component. That's where you're able to actually get a sense of social presence and a sense that you're actually co-present with other people within a shared experience. And I think that a lot of people think of, from the outside, that VR is going to be a very anti-social experience. And I think from the perspective of it does actually physically disconnect you from the people that are immediately around you. And in fact, it's a little bit of a taboo where anything that's blocking out your eyes from the world around you. So the idea of doing a VR experience in public has freaked people out a lot. There's a lot of different images of marks like we're walking down the aisleway with a whole room full of people and headsets. And I think that's part of it, is that we're kind of have this social expectation to have eye contact and be present and available to people. So I do think that virtual reality as a medium is going to be very private. It's something we're going to be doing in the privacy of our homes. But with that, you have the capability to be able to be connected to people around the world and to be able to unflatten what has otherwise been a very flattened type of experiences with doing things on social media. We're able to bring back a lot of the subtle social body language cues and kind of go move from, you know, there's just a new experience that was from Mind Show that premiered at VRLA, which is all about you going in and recording your sense of embodied expression, of almost like an improv acting. And instead of sending someone a text, you might like act it out within this alien character and start to have a conversation that's mediated through these stories that are unfolding through these improv acting. And the way that Cosmo Sharp was talking about it was that we're moving from this culture that's been focused on words and literacy, we're moving to post-symbolic expressions. and Charlie Melcher of the Future of Storytelling, he said that, you know, we're kind of moving back to this, what he thinks of as living stories. So the stories are actually being expressed through our body and through our intuition and our body language. And that he said that Socrates called it, anything that was written down is dead language because it was being disconnected from the ability being expressed from an individual. And so I think we're moving back to this living story. And I think that we're going to see a lot of social storytelling. Like, what's it mean to have a shared experience of storytelling? It's going to be a little bit more of like a group tour through, like being tour guided through the Dante's Inferno or something like that. It's going to be the experience more like a theme park ride would be one dimension of like social storytelling. But thinking about how you are actually able to incorporate interactive participatory communities when telling a story, rather than just one person from a singular perspective telling a story, it's going to be a lot more multiple perspectives coming together. One of that is through the interactive live dynamic participation that's happening, but also being able to step into different shoes and perspectives through an interview I did recently about situated knowledges. Depending on your perspective, you might have a different take of the story. So that's, and death is one that I would just pull out just because there's a lot of horror experiences, a lot of fear, and that I think is a, but also grief is going to be a big part. And I think the imagination of dreams also kind of goes into some ways where there's a lot of experiences where people are also going to be able to be taken and given opportunities to have experiences where they don't have mobility. The elderly and lonely, and this, that VR thing is going to be a huge part in that as well. So moving on, I just wanted to quickly talk about, this is from an interview I did with Devin Dolan. We kind of riffed back and forth, talking about the two different major axes of storytelling within VR. It's whether or not you're a character or a ghost, whether or not you have impact or no impact. And I think that almost every single media experience that you've had so far, you're a ghost without impact. You're just watching it and you have no agency. And Andrew Stern's here in the audience, and I think a lot of his work with the facade and behind the facade was also kind of really helpful flesh this out in terms of thinking about how much agency you have. Because in ghost without impact, you don't have any global agency, but you're not impacting the story at all. But yet, you may be still be able to look around and see what you are. You have a different experience. You can go and see it over and over and over again and have different experiences. And I think that you still have a little bit of local agency in that way. And one other thing that just reminds me of is that Eric Darnell, he says that the difference between film and VR is that VR, that film is that you're having one person tell you their story of their experience. Where VR, you're really giving somebody an experience that they're allowed to generate their own stories from. So you still have that sense of like the ability to mediate and shape your own experience, but that from that you have your stories to tell from that. Now just get to the character with impact, because that's essentially like the what everybody wants in terms of the most amount of agency, global agency and local agency, where you're able to have these interactions with artificial intelligent characters, and you're able to actually really feel like you're having a real conversation and you're social present with these kind of artificial NPCs, but you're able to have a different story that's actually unfolding and that it's engaging and interesting, and you're able to play it over and over and over again. Now, I think that's the thing that a lot of people are eventually moving towards, but it's something that's very difficult to do. I think talking about the combination of your agency with the story, those are two things that I think are fundamental in tension. So I'm going to dive into the presence a little bit. Mel Slater has this conceptualization that he says there's two main parts of presence. There's a place illusion and a plausibility illusion. The place illusion is just that you feel like you're in another world, but that comes from having head tracking and moving around and everything that's getting your perceptual system. You just believe at a kind of a primal level that you're in another place. Your rational brain is usually always aware that you're not actually in that place, but you have a lot of ability to actually trick your mind in a lot of ways that you have this sensation and feeling that you're in another place. Now the plausibility illusion is that this world is actually believable, it's coherent, it makes sense, all the rules are believable, there's nothing glitching out, people walking through walls or anything like that. And the plausibility illusion is the thing that's the most fragile when it comes to creating presence within virtual reality, because any little glitch that happens, it can immediately take you out of the experience. And it's much like real life when you're watching a movie, you see a giant pothole, and then the whole story just collapses, and you're like, okay, I'm not really bought into this story anymore because this is just ridiculous. I know I'm sitting in a movie theater, and this is not real. And I think this is like
let's go up.
Yep. Hello.
It's the bottom if you hold the button down.
That's one.
The other one's on.
All right, we're back. So the possibility is that once you lose it, it's really hard to get back because you kind of, the illusion's been broken. And so this is where a lot of like artificial intelligence and NPCs, but also I wanted to talk a little bit about like the uncanny valley. Because this actually comes up a lot in virtual reality. This is not a human. I think a lot of people would be able to identify that very quickly. This is a robot that is trying to look like a human, but there's something in your mind that's like, nope, not real, that is gross. And the reason why is that there is this idea of the uncanny valley. It's that if you have a cell phone, you're like, you don't have that feeling that it's gross. And you get closer and closer to looking like a human, and then there's this huge drop off where it's either like a zombie or a too realistic humanoid robot, or you go up to like a human healthy person. And that jump, I think, is there's an evolutionary component there because when you're around zombies and people are dead, that's actually like very dangerous, right? You're kind of trained that you might be in danger. So we've learned to pick up on all these subtle body language cues, and our threshold for us deciding whether or not something's real or not is actually really high. And that's what I think the video game industry is really felt with in terms of trying to create this photorealism. But yet, the more you do that, the more you just have this drop-off that happens. And so this is an example of an avatar that's really photorealistic, and it looks great when it's just a still. When you're seeing this in a VR experience, you automatically know it's like, okay, that looks real, but it's not real, because they're not doing all these things that a real human would be doing. They're not interacting with me, they're not blinking, they're not having these real body language. And so then immediately it just feels like it just breaks the illusion. And so I think a lot of people who try to go to this photorealism route don't realize this trade-off between that plausibility. And so a lot of the different major studios that do animation, they've tried different examples where they've actually tried to do this photorealism route. And they find that people, again, find it gross. And so they have their own ways of stylizing the different avatars. And Betty Moeller is someone who's done some research to do these different dialing down and show blend the avatar in an augmented way. So they'll add it like a 33% Disney or a 66% Pixar. And what they found is that the things that they find is the look of like the most gross is like either 100% or 0%. So people want to have some level of stylization in order to trick the mind into telling it that it's not real. And because we have expectations, and whenever our expectations are a reality, then we expect everything to be like, the sound has to be great, the audio has to be great, it has to look great, and have all the social behaviors. But when you start to do this fantasy world, then you have different expectations, and you can actually be more present. So this is just an example of like AltSpace. A lot of social VR experiences are doing this sort of very stylized approach, or converge. Again, this is just moving heads around, and again, very low poly aesthetic, and that low poly aesthetic can actually create more presence. So when people are thinking about like design agencies creating experiences on the web or like web VR, you don't have to be striving for photorealism, because that actually is going to not be a very present experience. You can actually do something that's very stylized like this and still have something that's a very transportive experience. Like this is another example, Surge. This is one of the most popularly rated experiences on Oculus, and it's an amazing music video, and it's not photorealistic at all, but it puts you into this fantasy world. And I think that is some level of what people want from VR, is to be transported into another world. And so I just wanted to kind of wrap up here by going to what I have kind of identified as the different dimensions of presence, because Mel Slater has these ideas of place illusion, plausibility illusion, but yet I would have all these experiences within VR where it was like, but there's something more, there's something different. You know, like the Oculus Toy Box Cinema was probably the one experience that if anybody has done it, they see that it's kind of hit all these different dimensions of embodied presence, social presence, active presence, and emotional presence. So I'll just explain a little bit what I mean here. So embodied presence, that's really about having your physical body feeling like you're actually in a virtual experience. And so there's this idea called the virtual body ownership illusion, which means that when you're in VR and you have your entire body tracked, then right now you just have your arms tracked to your body, but eventually, just a couple days ago, announced that you'd be able to track your body. So when you have your full body tracked, you actually start to identify that that's your body. Like, whenever you look down and say, is this my body? Like, 100% of the time in your life up to this point, the answer's been yes. So, when you go into a VR experience and you're like, is this my body? And it's like, oh, it's moving, yep, this is me. So we're like, we've just been trained. I mean, a lot of times people that are kind of now having experiences with that's not true, but on the whole, your entire life, you've down there too. So it's very easy to invoke this virtual body image illusion, and one of them is actually through haptics. And so, just being able to track something, and if you see it, touching your hand and moving, then that'll actually kind of really trick your mind into believing that that's your hand. And they'll have the rubber hand illusion as one way. So that's a body. The social dimension is just that you're co-present with other people, and you actually kind of believe that you're there. And you forget that there are kind of these either floating heads or some sort of digital representations of them. You just feel like you're actually hanging out with other people. So the sense of social presence, I think, is a huge component. That whenever you add the social dimension, that is just increasing your level of presence. The active presence is interesting because whenever you're doing different activities, like anybody that's on job simulator or tilt brush, you can kind of get lost in the activity. Like you're operating and manipulating tools and you're doing something, and you know, the guys from job simulator out in the labs, they actually call it hand presence because you see your hands and you're not holding an object, but you start to hold an object and then your hands disappear, and now all of a sudden you're just manipulating the world with a knife or whatever that you have in your hands. And so that's part because this active presence is that you're doing stuff in the world and you're just completely focused on that. And it's kind of simulating how we kind of tune out the parts that we're not paying attention to. If you have a knife, you're just focusing on that. So the active presence in the toy box demo, you're like throwing physics bricks around and throwing firecrackers in other people's face. And it's just like this, like real-time physics really helps sell like presence. But the activities that you're doing, whether it's you're physically moving around or moving your body, there's a huge difference between doing something on an Xbox controller and doing something with a 6 degree of freedom with having your hands trapped. And that's hard because you have this better sense that you're actually exerting your will into the world in a way. And this abstraction through the Xbox controller just don't give you the same level of active presence, which I think in a lot of ways explains why the HTC Vive has been so much more kind of a grassroots success in terms of the most advanced VR experiences, because a lot of them are invoking that active presence. And finally, is emotional presence. Now, this is the one where I think it's mostly for storytelling in a lot of ways, to really focusing on building that empathy. And in some ways, like I was saying earlier, taking away these other things can actually kind of focus the emotional in a lot of ways. So there's a lot of storytelling experiences that are emotional, but the toy box demo was just fun. You know, it's hard to, but that's also, that fun is coming from other people. And so I think anytime you're involving other people, you are inherently including the emotional dimension, because we're emotional creatures, and by including the social dimension, then you're kind of including the emotion just out of the box. But there are specific things you can do in terms of storytelling. There are things to create an environment that's emotional. There are different music that's emotional. But the emotional component, I think, is a huge part of creating this presence, but it's one I think is probably the most overlooked over these four. Again, I think in VR, the interesting thing is that we have all of these happening all the time in our lives, but we don't necessarily pay attention to it because they're just always happening. In VR, you're like taking away every one of these things, and you're adding them back in, and you have to like build them up from scratch. And I think that by doing that, you're able to start to combine things in different ways, you know, like just doing things that's active and social, or something that's embodied and emotional. So that's all the big things that I had. You know, I've done a lot of things specifically about storytelling. I could go on and on for hours about that, but I wanted to just give you a brief overview of a lot of the ideas that I have in terms of the landscape, as well as the kind of the components that I found that are really crucial for cultivating a sense of presence within the VR experience. And, yeah, I will stop there, and I want to thank you for listening. Thank you.
Yep, I sure can.
All Reynolds, everyone.
Hey, intermission. Tell everybody to put that on their cards. Hey, everybody. So this is my first time presenting in a few years publicly. So I spent all weekend working on these slides. So the first thing, I just want to share a quick story. I was making these slides and I worked on them all weekend, and I have them up on my monitor in our living room. And like, I did a double take, and I'm like, yes. I was like, what is familiar about this? And I was like, holy shit, that is my 7th grade social studies textbook cover.
Fourth edition.
Yeah. Instrument errors in the textbook design. Your guy. So, super quick background about me. Lived all over the place. Most of that working in software and working in real-time 3D. That mostly means video games. In about 2005 or 2006, I got the entrepreneurial hair and started doing various 3D things for non-video games. And then I did a bunch of other stuff too, like a co-working space over here in little South Carolina. And then eventually I got this call from my friend Graham that asked me to come to Florida. So actually my buddy Spencer and I, we've been doing a lot of 3D work, and our friend Graham, this is 2013, just to give you a time frame, was like, I'm going to go work with this company magically, and I can see things in the room that I can't tell if they're real or not. You guys should come check it out. So we were super skeptical, but we wound up in Florida at this nondescript office building. Seriously, over here was a shooting range, like out in the open, and you had to literally walk past the shooting range to get to the office. But here's where I saw the future. So this is a much newer photo. This is a photo that was in the Wired cover of Magic Leaf most recently. But the point is when we got to this nondescript office park, beside the dentist office in Florida, they had this one machine. It was the one machine Magic Leaf had at the time, and it was called a bench top. And the reason why it was called a bench top is because it was rigidly mounted just like this, and you could really only look through it. And that's it. You could just stick your head at it and look to see what you could see. And it was rigidly mounted like that so we could perform experiments and see different stuff. But it was really just, just surreal to be in this room and to stick our head in there. So we saw the demos, and we were impressed, but not that impressed. So we were like, your technology is awesome, but we've been working in interactive 3D for so long. Your demos can be so much more interactive. Like, let us have this some hardware. So we were in South Carolina at the time, and we decided to move to Florida. My wife is here tonight. She's very supportive of that move. She deserves a round of applause from all of us here. So we were like, we saw some cool stuff, but like, it could be better. Like, we come from a background of interactivity, building video games, building these interactive experiences. And, just imagine if you were like, holy crap, I can actually help this company out. So that was kind of our mentality. So my buddy Spencer and I actually joined the company at the same time. And unfortunately, I have no photos of these moments, so I'm going to try to paint them as best I can. So the reason why the demo sucked was because that machine was the machine. And, there were random investors in and in to see it. They were demoing it all the time. There was one poor guy that worked on the third floor and the machine's on the first floor. He put together what he could. But we were like, you're going to have to give us access to this machine if you want to see anything cool with it. So we actually talked the company into giving us a whole 5 days unfettered access to the machine. And we came up with the idea of having a picture on the wall in the back of the room. It was kind of a long room. And again, keep in mind, you're like sitting at this machine, it's like an eye exam machine. You can't move, There's no real interactivity. And so on the back wall, we were like, we'll put a picture up there that looks like a real picture. And so credit to my buddy Spence, he actually lighted and shaded it to match the room that we were in. And it was the true first moment I had where I could not tell if something was real or virtual. When you look through it, you saw the real world, you saw the real room, you saw that back wall, and then there's a framed picture there that I genuinely couldn't discern it from the back wall I was looking at. And then our idea was a little dragon would come out of that picture and then come perch on your finger. So we worked on it for a few days, and then we got to the point where the little dragon's coming out, and you're watching it fly around the room, and then you literally hold out your finger, and the dragon come perch on it. And so I'm the guy writing all the code for it. Spencer's making all the art for it. We know how the machine works. We know the technology behind it. But that first moment, I'm watching this dragon come out of the wall, and he's like 6 inches tall, and I feel like he's probably a half pound. And I hold out my finger, and he perched on my finger, like he flapped to kind of a slow stop and hovered down. I uncontrollably laughed like a child. Big grown man, just laughing my ass off. I think it was probably 9 o'clock at night in this like nondescript office building beside the dentist's office. And I'm working with this technology, and I'm like, what is this? Like, what's really going on here? And I think everybody eventually knew that they're onto some special technology, but I think it goes bigger than just the specific tech. And that's what really got me thinking, like, we're really on this precipice of accessing human perception in ways we never have before. And it kind of opens up all kinds of questions. And so the other part of that story that I left off is the reason why I think I laughed was, I think I felt the dragon land on my finger. I know I felt the dragon land on my finger. And I was like, how did that happen? And then I've given dozens of demos over the year, or hundreds of demos over the years, and people tell me crazy stuff. Like, I feel like this thing is making heat, or I feel like this thing is breathing on me. And you start to think about, what are we messing with here? What are we tapping into? So I've had a lot of time to think about it. And so then I want to take a step back and think about, what is reality? And so in this moment right now, what makes this reality to us? Like, what are the things that make us feel like this is real? We're receiving tons of signals, right? So our brain kind of coalesces those together. And so if you start to kind of use this theory of reality that we're building this mental model, a lot of stuff in my experience starts to make more sense. So that's why it's become my theory. So to kind of tie it back into what Ken had talked a little bit about, in presence, I'm super simplifying this, there's many subsystems involved. There's proprioception, which is kind of your sense of your own self. It's how you can like scratch your foot without looking. It's like how you know your body. And what I'm going to focus on is exteroception, which is basically our sense of ourself in reality, based off these signals we're constantly receiving. Many of these signals are physical forces, like gravity, and then other are, you know, touch, obviously. Sound is a powerful one, and then light is probably the one left that we haven't really messed with too much, and that's what's interesting about it. So, if you think about, make sure I covered all the points here. So if you think about this, like, model-making function in your brain, so our reality is really not what we see. Our eyes are not cameras. We have this kind of spatial awareness. We have this awareness of where we are right now. And you think you have a good handle on what's around you, but honestly, you don't. You have to constantly look and refresh it. And so you're processing these signals. So I think about all these signals we're bombarded with, and we coalesce those into what we call our reality. And then that's all just totally modeled in our mind. Another example I like to give is, like, if you try to picture something in your mind's eye or when you dream, you don't see it with the same detail you see in the moment that you're looking at the light that's bouncing off stuff. So that's kind of an example of how your mind can render stuff for you without the incoming signal. And it's real vague and blurry and weird. And that's kind of what gives us this sense of reality. So I think true mixed reality, because mixed reality is kind of an overloaded term, and there's still debate in the industry about about this term. And unfortunately, on the VR side, it's gotten mixed up a little bit even more, because when they do these recordings of people working in VR, that's become known as mixed reality cameras. But in my opinion, mixed reality is when we basically recreate these digital signals sufficiently enough, they don't have to be perfect. That's the other good thing about human perception. It's pretty tolerant. Then we can bypass the kind of high alert mode we go into and things won't start checking out. And so for the most part of this presentation, I want to focus on vision because it's such a powerful, it's, like I said, I truly believe it's one of the last few things we honestly trust. Like if I see it, I believe it. And if, you know, if I can reach out and touch it, I believe it. But it's such a powerful input into this modeling engine in our minds. So I really want to focus on tapping into that visual cortex for a minute. So if we want to tap into human perception, and we want to tap into visual cortex, first thing we need to do is to wire a really powerful computer straight into visual cortex, and that's what we do eventually. Just kidding. Sorry. And I'm not representing magic, but it's not happening. There's no head tags. There's no matrix style ports. It turns out these two guys are pretty wired into your visual cortex pretty well. So we really don't need to hack around those. The other beauty of these things is they take light as input. Pretty simple to create photons. So let's just keep those. Let's don't cut those out. Let's don't go around them. Let's figure out how to work with these guys. So what do I mean by that? So right now, when we process light, you know, photons come from a source, let's say it's some hokey icon of the sun, and it bounces off a physical object. And our eyes are designed to process this light coming from different distances. Encoded in the signal coming into our eye is color and depth. So basically, we're completely bombarded by these photons. There's no way we can process all the photons we're bombarded with, even in a dark environment. Right. So basically, our if you think about the fact that we're not just looking at flat screens all the time, we're looking at the world, and it's bouncing off all these different things. So then, back to the idea that we're building these models in our mind, and they're constantly being refreshed, right? So our eyes are constantly scanning, and we basically fixate, but we don't know what we're looking at. Like, you know, here's a little exercise for you. Stay focused where you are currently, but think about what's to your side. Can you really re-render that in your mind? You have to look at it, right? So we're constantly sampling around. So the good news is that you are filling in a lot of details with your mind, and you get a lot of benefit from the human perception system when you do that. But if you can feed in the right kind of light, you can take advantage of this. I'm going to get a little more technical with it. So over here is the real world. So when we focus on something or we fixate on something, both of our eyes fixate on that point, they toe in to verge on that point. And once we decide we want to focus on that point, your eyes change shape, the lens changes shape, because it assumes the light's coming from that distance, and that's how you draw focus, and that's how you create this input signal for what's happening in your reality. And so what you get is, in this C quadrant here, is you notice there's like a little blurriness. You're basically focusing past anything or aft anything in your fixation point. And then the problem that you hear talked about a lot, it's called the accommodation vergence mismatch. So it's called, so you have your vergence, which is your eyes towing in, and then that focus one is called accommodation. So, and here it's called focal distance. But over here is kind of what you hear talked about a lot is this mismatch. And what it is that the light signal coming in VR usually is coming from a single depth, and it doesn't have a focal cue on it. And so you're basically looking, you're trying to focus on this virtual object with the lights coming from a different place. So there's a lot of speculation about how bad is this, how much mismatch can we handle, and really is it that important? I personally don't think it's that important in terms of it's going to damage you or make you, you know, go cross-eyed or something, but I do think it's important that if you're not starting to create virtual things that match what your natural relaxed perception system is processing, you go into high alert mode, and you do got to go into this mental mode. Yes, like Tim described, the rational mind versus the primal mind, and the rational mind kind of starts to take over a little bit more than you want it to. But it can cause there are physical effects. It can cause discomfort, eye fatigue, headaches, and that type of thing. So what I like about these new mixed reality technologies, it's an optical view through. So that means you can see the real world. It's not a camera, it's not a digital camera streaming the real world into your eye. You can actually see the real world and process it normally. So you're kind of in this relaxed state. And then if that digital content is being delivered at a signal that sufficiently matches what you're fixating on or fixating past, then you get all kinds of crazy benefits tapping the perception. That's why I felt the dragon on my finger. Because in that moment, I'm watching that dragon fly from the back of the room towards my finger, and I'm properly fixated on that dragon. And it's changing focus appropriately. So everything's checking out, so I'm relaxed. My brain's not trying to sort it out. So then when it comes up to my finger, I anticipate that that's going to feel like a little dragon on my finger. And I kind of mentally start, you kind of mentally start anticipating these things without even realizing it. And even if you're aware of what's going on technically. So it's really powerful. So you couple this ability with all this great new technology. So computer vision is a big part of it. So the example here is you've got a picture of a room. They fed it to a computer, running computer vision algorithms. And it's basically detected that that's a bed and that's a chair. Not only detected that it's a bed and it's a chair, but actually figured out the orientation of it. Now, sure, that's like a wooden straight leg chair. It's like a rolling office chair in its place. However, if you're a storyteller and having a chair is important in the scene, and you can already detect the orientation properly and a bed properly, think about the things you can do with that in a dynamic environment. Huh. And here's another example down here. You know, again, the chairs aren't perfectly the same chair, but the fact that it recognized that they were chairs to the point where you figure out the orientation, and it figured out that there was enough of a tabletop over here to give you a table surface. Well, if your authoring tools allow you to say, well, if this person happens to be in the room and there's a table there, and I want this, you know, just keep using the dragon flies in and hangs out on the table, you know, you have that ability here. So it's really powerful once you start playing these things. Then you have input. So it's not interactive if you don't have input. So there's all kinds of amazing innovations happening in input in the past couple of years. And Kent touched on these as well. This is the vibe. I call this sixth off input. Sometimes it's called motion input, where basically your hands are being tracked in full 6 degrees of freedom, and you can naturally just draw. Think about how people have learned how to draw with a mouse or a wacom tablet. Can just like draw, like picking up a pencil. And by the way, I think this is one of the things they show in the cookie shop space here. They play with another powerful input that hasn't quite really emerged yet, but I think it's really powerful is eye input. So tracking the eyes. So again, think about this ability to display naturally, and then now you know where the person's fixated. So that's a huge benefit. And there's a well-done eye input that's really impressive. You become skeptical, you're like skeptical, but it's really natural. I mean, think about just, and then voice. So it was really hard to find a gift of voice, but it's cool. So hopefully everybody knows that's the Amazon Echo. And it's kind of showing people the power of voice input. And I'm the biggest voice input skeptic. Like, I don't use voice commands in a car or anything. But think about these things combined where I can look at something and it's tracking where I'm looking, and then I get the context of what I'm saying. So if I say that thing over there, I can start combining these things. So I can be a little more vague about, I can actually interact with things a little more naturally. And then finally, gesture. Or natural hand inputs. This is something you can do in the cookie shop here, where basically your finger hands are tracks and all your articulated fingers are tracks. And so input's getting really, really good. So you start thinking about this, we're tapping in the perception system. We can render things that are hard to tell from real. And we're like able to allow you to input in more natural ways. It starts to open up a lot of possibilities. So think about that. You like, I've not seen it, and it's hard to describe, but there's going to be the ability to create totally synthetic content that people cannot discern from the real world. That's powerful in both good and bad. Really hard to describe it. And you guys are like, so that sounds awesome. How do I use it? Right? Because that's the point. Like, we want to tell stories. Like, how can I get my hands around this? So, I got bad news. So, the bad news is right now, is everything's rendered in real-time 3D. And real-time 3D has been a black art of video game development and like all sorts of crazy experiences. The tools and the learning curve are like nothing you've ever had to deal with before if you didn't come from game development world. And so you could work with this tech right now today. Everything I've talked about so far, you start playing with, but the learning curve might be steep if you're not experienced in real-time 3D. But there is good news. The good news is I think tools are going to evolve. Right now, we're working with game engines and video game technology. It's kind of easy because those things have been commoditized already in the video game world, and it's just easy to patch those things into these new systems. But I think they're going to evolve to become more native to these platforms. And the good news is, most of you have lived in 3D your entire life, so it shouldn't be that hard to figure out and make stuff in 3D. Most of you. So my advice is still early days, right? It's not too late. The train's not leaving the station by any means. First, think about what would you do with these abilities? Like, what's not only what's possible, but like, how can we do things differently? How can we use these tried and true storytelling methods and design methods and like thoughtful design and all these methods, right? So just think about this, you know, trust me that this thing's coming and these things work the way I say they do. What would you do with this ability? That's my biggest recommendation. But keep in mind, just like Ken covered, you don't control the context as much anymore. You don't know what environment some of these experiences will happen in. So hopefully the tools will enable you to make the most of it, but how do you create experiences that transcend any particular context? Because you can't control the frame anymore. There is no screen. So my advice, think sparse, in particular for mixed reality. Mixed reality is more suited to, you know, again, just to clarify, when I mean mixed reality, I talk about this ability to still see the real world, but also see this virtual content at the same time. Right now, I think it lends itself more to magical moments. And I think VR is the place you can go when you want to create a magical. So if you want to have like, you don't want to be in people's face with the tech, right? So if people are using this, you want them to see mostly a normal room and then be like, well, okay, what's the big deal? And then they see the crazy dragon of it. But if you've got an idea that more requires you to control the environment, the magical story, and it has to be a world, I'd recommend VR. But always think about native experiences not possible on any other platform. We've learned this from mobile, we've learned this from web. When you take advantage of what's unique to the platform and really delight people with it, those always win. So that's, you know, and you know, to kind of underscore that even more, I think the point is like, it's still early days. Like, think about this ability and this power and what we can do in your everyday work. But know that still a good design, good story is always win. So here's a magic moment. So for people that have followed Magic Leap, this was kind of I think after we did our V-Run funding, we started being a little more public. And honestly, this is still one of my more favorite things we put out there. Admittedly, this was originally started out as a video that was rendered, but we did turn it into a real demo with a real tech. But to me, this is a magic moment. you can see your real hands, and that's all checking out, your perception system's checking out. And then you see this elephant that seems to be mostly checking out, so then you relax and you're totally enamored by it. That's Kiki, the elephant. I love Kiki. Quick aside about Kiki the elephant. So when that video came out, I'm a big fan of social media. I was following all the Magic Leap chatter. Obviously just behind the scenes stuff. But it was funny when that video came out, somebody posted this on Reddit. And then said I got it. So then, you know, we talk about the power of this ability, and hopefully we're all thinking about the good opportunities in that, but there's some bad, right? Yeah. So if anybody hasn't seen this, this is hyper-reality. They're going to come out with more. It's the hyper-reality.co. The interesting thing about it, I think he's a Japanese director and creative director, and it was executive produced by a guy out of Maryland that does Bully Entertainment, which actively works in VR and AR space, and they know what they're talking about. This video is really interesting, depressing and inspiring all the way. So I'll just point some stuff out. So remember this ability to track where we're looking, and this ability to render things that feel like they're in the real world. And so just make that a given in this moment. But notice there's a little doggy here on the shopping cart, virtual, of course. And the doggy's like, I sure would like a coconut. And then you're like, oh, here's some real coconuts over here highlighted. And if you buy one, you get upgrade your coconut. So it's a little gamification, like there's some points attached to it. It's, there's some ad over here. And you're like, okay, so this could go real long, real fast. But think about how we use mobile and web today. We're in an attention economy, right? So you could easily see this power going this direction. So I really love to point this out. So there's a group, there's a design group in Seattle called Artifacts. John Rousseau is there. And he proposed these three laws of mixed reality. Sorry about that, the text got a little wacky in the conversion. But basically, mixed reality must enhance our ability for mindful attention. We can't continue down this path of fragmented attention. The shared human experience, a lot of what Ken was talking about, the ability to see the world and these virtual things at the same time shouldn't separate us more. So let's figure out how to share experiences and not be even more disconnected than we are. And then economics, commerce and data, because when I'm cracking your eyes, I know what product you're looking at. And when I'm showing you something, I can completely control what you see. So it's kind of these primal laws around making sure things don't go that way. And then so I also want to show a little gift here too, to show you how crazy it looks in actual animation. And this is not crazy. This tech is here now. I can hold an object and we can render virtually on it. This is not science fiction anymore. So that's kind of where I wanted to just kind of inspire some thoughts around what do you do with this power and this ability, what's gonna and what could potentially be bad with it. And I want to encourage everyone to embrace this one. Don't be afraid of it. Go to the cookie shop, do demos, experience these things. Anyone can get a cardboard set up. Especially if you're in Portland, there's so many meetups. Oregon Storyboard is constantly doing workshops and meetups. Get out, talk to people about this tech, see this tech. Don't be afraid of it. Bubble design always wins over novelty. People that always overuse the tech and try to be in your face with it, those never last, right? I'll show each other cool shit, man.
Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Ken. Are you guys up for a little Q&A?
Yeah.
Awesome.
So we have a few minutes here for some Q&A. Anyone has any questions? Here's one of two. Thomas.
Yeah, I was curious about what you put on all.
Yes. Wait, who asked that?
I did.
Oh, what brought me to Portland? I wrote a blog post about it. So we want to get out of Florida, versus Florida. we really like the West Coast. We have a bunch of mutual friends that had either lived here or loved it here, and they kind of knew our lifestyle of like beer and bicycles and brunch. So that was set. But we came here, and I met with a few people, Frank Torres being one of the first ones. So back to my pre-Magic League days, I'm a big fan of community and like the power of community. And when I saw how genuine the community here was, and then I saw the raw ingredients of creativity, innovation, and then like just the beauty of the city, we totally are head over heels in love with it. So my goal is to come here and to help raise awareness and connect people, because I really think Portland can be a hub of these developing for these new platforms, the same way Portland kind of gained a reputation for doing real high quality mobile development and open source development. I think all those raw ingredients really contribute to what it would take to be a hub here. So that's what brought us here.
So I'm really interested in haptics, and so if you guys can talk about haptics in the context of what you just talked about, what you're seeing developing in haptics and how it's
going to
influence presence?
Yeah, I think so. First of all, I think visuals dominates. Visual systems is what everyone's focusing on right now. The next frontier is sound, because that's the next lowest hanging fruit. Visualized sound, and also like real-time generated sounds from the physics engine that's sort of like down the road. I think haptics is that next area. I think it's like super hard and difficult. And if you look over the Uncanny Valley trail off, it's so easy to just go straight into the Uncanny Valley. Done a number of different interviews with that. So our haptics sort of like a response rate of our skin is like once every 20,000 times a second. You know, it's like insane in terms of the fidelity that our touch needs. And it's not only just the hands, it's our entire body. So I think most of the successful haptics that I've seen so far make a deliberate attempt to go down and fidelity to make super simple like rumbles and like just like in within the controllers to do, and also haptics that are very specific to a use case. So let me have someone do like a training for doing biopsies and having the force distribution of what it feels like to put a tool into the different layers of skin and have that very precise. But you're basically manipulating an object. So you have these very expensive $20,000 to $30,000 haption arms that can simulate that for doctors or for space exploration. At the SIGGRAPH this year, there's a lot of different haptic experiments, but a lot of them end up being frustratingly like awkward, and you're like, okay, this is not real. This is not like adding to the experience is just kind of annoying. There was however the synesthesia shoot which was super cool, and that was like 20 different things around your body, and it's like buzzing, rotating, and it's during Res Infinite, which is like this super stylized game. And so because the game was like stylized and you're being input, and there were certain things when you actually like achieve something in the game, your whole body would buzz. And it was like, oh my god, this is amazing. I have to like win that this game in order to like get this stimulation to my body. But I think right now, like most haptic stuff, like mixed reality is probably the other realm. So it's something like the Void, which is using walls as a haptic device, so anything like touching walls. And I think that doing OptiTrack, and this is really getting like beyond room scale, so like VR arcades, you have to have like these expensive OptiTrack things, you have like real physical objects, you have objects you're able to actually interact with, so this mixed reality type of things. That's like the most successful haptics that I've seen, because you just believe it when you're seeing it, but you're also feeling it. There's all that, a lot of things you do with the visual field, which is a trick in your mind to what you're seeing as well. So doing things like redirected walking, where you're walking what looks like you're walking straight, but you're actually touching the wall that's curving, then it makes your mind think that it gives you that extra sense of feeling real. But most of the stuff that I've seen out there is like frustratingly like awkward and not there yet. And I think that it's like, actually the other thing I say is the Subpack is an audio haptic which goes in frequencies between 5 and 35 hertz, which is like subaudible, but yet it is viscerally putting those frequencies into your body. So a lot of the different VR things you see now that are at these conferences, they're using Subpacks in order to give you that extra level of haptics and doing sound design. And that low frequency register that isn't audible, but yet you get a lot of impact with that. So that's what people have seen doing.
I'm a production realist. Like, I don't need stuff people can experience now. So I kind of just reiterate, like, you can do amazing stuff with haptics, but if it costs $100,000 and you gotta wire somebody up for 30 minutes to get them, it's like just not on my radar. So I'm more usually along those lines, kind of like the Void stuff, which is basically you're in control of the environment. You put someone in VR, and then they like the environment. You could have a plank of plywood on sawhorses, but in VR it looks like this really, you know, this table. And when they set this virtual object on the table, their heel of their hand is striking the table. To me, I think that's your most pragmatic approach right now. I mean, assuming, you know, beyond like your video game haptics, which is like vibration and kind of like just a little bit of a vibration feedback in the hands. And then, you know, the optical view through mixed reality stuff, AR stuff, you can see the real world. And so then it's more about making sure the simulation understands the physical objects around. So yeah, you know, I think there's a ton of really amazing technology in haptics, and I think you can feel things that is amazing, but I don't want to describe them yet.
One thing I've been interested in is the confluence of AI, machine learning, and VR. One thing I've noticed in doing a little VR development myself is that AI and VR are bad. It really sucks. It's something that's almost intolerable. Was if you're a 3D game engine, you're like, oh. Have you seen anybody right now that's been evolving those two to make more realistic AI?
Yeah, sitting right behind you is Amy Cerner, who's been working on playable AI and did this on. You know, it's probably some of, like, I think Andrew's probably, like, a lot of ways 10, 15 years ahead of a lot of people out there thinking about it, but I think there is a lot of other people that are starting to get into it. And I think the trend that we're seeing, I saw a number of people, AI has been coming up a lot more that I went to the International Joint Conference for Artificial Intelligence and did, like, 60 interviews a week and 24 hours worth of content. And so I'll be spinning on the voices of AI, and I get sort of my company that I just started this past week sort of be able to get the pipeline to do a daily VR and AI podcast. But I'd say a lot of the technologies are natural language processing in terms of being able to actually interpret what people are saying, but not only interpret, but understand the meaning behind it. So I think a lot of things that I've seen so far out in the wide world are using different cloud-based APIs in terms of the API and Watson, which I did an interview with George Dolbey talking about some people doing stuff there. Google Voice API is going to be a big thing in terms of putting things in and being able to interpret it. I think some Microsoft is going to have some cloud-based services as well. So a lot of these different AI to be able to deal with natural language input is going to be handled in the cloud and not necessarily happening locally. And then there's a lot of procedural generation stuff, creative AI. There's a conference that's coming up here right after Oculus Connect about the Artificial Intelligence, Interaction Design, and Entertainment. It's called AIDE. That's where all the most cutting-edge interactive drama and creative AI people are going to be at. So I'm going to be attending there, doing a lot more interviews, kind of really seeing what the cutting edge is. Because really, the VR community is lagging behind. There's some people that are working on stuff, but there's a lot of people out there, like, not in VR, that are, you know, working on this for years and years and years. And so I do think that VR is going to be this interface where we have a lot of these interactions with chatbots, and the trend does seem to be that we're going to be moving away from text input and language, and we are going to be doing natural language input conversational interfaces. And so I do think that the future of input within these virtual and augmented reality, mixed reality environments is going to be through speech. Right now, the training of those speeches is done through these huge amounts of data that is coming from these big companies where you have to use their cloud services. I'm looking forward to the day where people kind of figure out how to match like the more traditional AI with the more cutting edge machine learning to be able to do, like, for example, an interview with a woman who said, you read a Wikipedia article and you read that this bird has this characteristics and then you do one-shot learning, like you're able to see it and do it. Right now, most of the training for artificial intelligence takes hundreds of thousands of examples to be able to extract the features, and then it's sort of like this black box of determining. But when you start to add in like more symbolic reasoning into machine learning, then you'll be able to have something that's a little bit more feasible to learn on the fly. And it could be not necessarily requiring everything to be processed offside of the fly. So some thoughts.
Yeah, Kent's way more into the, yes. I mean, from my perspective, there's two definitions, and like deep learning is kind of a big forerunner right now, which is like that running off huge data sets type. My exposure to it is less on the direct user interaction side and more on like, you know, a lot of this kind of sensing of the environment is very computer vision based, and a lot of computer vision stuff is writing these algorithms and hand tuning them. And deep learning is an interesting approach, alternative to that, which is like, you know, building these deep learning algorithms and weights and training them on recognizing any potential coffee mug in the scene, as opposed to like writing these very fragile algorithms around trying to recognize coffee mug in the scene. So that part of it, but then the interaction part, which the, you know, like the chatbot side of it, I think is a precursor to that kind of natural language interaction. That's definitely coming, because if all of a sudden you're interacting with technology, if the human-computer interface is no longer at a screen, how much longer are you going to deal with keyboard and mouse, right? And I think keyboard and mouse is great, but I think it will be a primary input for a little while, but eventually the evolution's got to change at some point.
I'm curious about those narratives and symbolic communication, like how far off what you're specifically. 90%
of communication is nonverbal. Yeah, I think that's so. Mind Show was a demo that was just shown at VRLA. It's Cosmos Sharp and a lot of people who started VRLA. So it's Visionary VR as the company in Mind Show. So what you would do is that you would get in this environment and you would pick the characters, set it up, but they actually had a scene played out, right? So you would get like an email message from somebody saying, oh, hey, this is the stub of an interaction, and there's somebody sort of like, oh my God, I'm like being attacked. So then you step into the role of being the monster, right? You're in a first-person perspective. You act out the scene, and it's from your perspective, and you're like reacting to the other actor and what they're doing, you know? So, but then you stand, step out of yourself, and you actually watch yourself acting out the scene, which is really the trippiest thing I've seen, because it's the first time I had this like third-person objective witnessing consciousness of this thing that I just did. You know, I've never had that before. You know, so I think that we're going to start having a lot more of that, but that their platform allows you to start to create an entire scene of that, right? Where, you know, the thing about VR is that, and I hear this from everybody that's been doing social VR, is that you're able to start to actually notice people's body language and identify who's who based upon how they're moving around and how they're just like speaking and their cadence. And just like, if you just turn off the audio, I know Phil Rosedale from High Fidelity says that you can just put people in High Fidelity and start acting, you like, you'll be able to identify people based upon how they're moving around. And so you start to get to that a little bit where you'll be able to construct entire scenes. But I think that, so there's been some podcasts that I did about Snapchat, and that's probably the most sophisticated post-symbolic, you know, language. It's really visual communication. Like Snapchat's a camera company, they're doing both photos and video that people are going beyond text. And so we have a whole Z generation that's training themselves how to operate in a world that is this kind of post-symbolic communication through all these digital avatars that they have. But I sort of, there's an article in TechCrunch that was talking about this, moving from the information age to the experiential age. I think Snapchat is a good marker of that in terms of that's a company to look to see, watch what they're doing, and you can see where all this is going. And Pokemon Go is just sort of one symptom of this kind of like augmented reality as an interface to your rest of the world. But Snapchat is like, I think, in a lot of ways, the leading AI company because they have the mind share, and yet the technology is going to come. They don't need to make these huge technological breakthroughs, but they have the people, the user base, and people that are actually using it day to day. The other thing I just put out there is that they have a better combination of private and public. I think Facebook has been moving towards eroding privacy and tricking you into thinking that it's private and then turning it public. And I think that right now Snapchat has this really nice balance between what's private and what's public, and that's really helping foster that communication because people feel safe to experiment and then it disappears. And so, yeah, that's what it's saying.
Yeah, I don't know if that answers your question, but to follow up on the Snapchat side of it, we have been a huge fan of Snapchat for a long time. And yes, don't underestimate them. And like, I had a friend that was working with them, and you know, he made the point of that huge user base is highly experimental. And so they can rapidly iterate on all these new things and throw them out there, and if they don't stick, that's kind of the Snapchat way, it'll get pulled out and changed. Definitely don't underestimate Snapchat as a you know, powerful new thing. Definitely a bridge experience between what I would call AR and you know, current mobile kind of communication and social. I put the Snapchat lenses on like magazine covers and TV. You want to model. That's kind of a taste of like you're controlling your reality. And like what I'm saying, when I'm at a grocery store and like this rack of people, ugly people magazines, kind of funny because they're all dog faces. So imagine being able to do that even more so and share even more. And that's the other cool part about it is the ease of sharing. So yeah, I kind of deviated a little bit, but Snapchat is definitely they're not going away anytime soon.
Yeah, just one more part of the narrative part, because I just did an interview with Charlie Melcher of the Future of Storytelling, and started out living stories. I mentioned it briefly, but I think one of the things we talk about there is immersive theater, sort of like the Sleep No More and Punch Drunk, where you're actually interacting live in real time with actors and they're able to respond to you in a lot of ways. And so, in terms of narrative, I think that type of interactive narrative where, again, when you talk about agency, you have local agency, but there's no real global agency. Like, you're not really changing the story. But there are these little interactions where you have these one-on-one like scenarios where they pull you aside and they take you on an adventure where it is very much like you have a lot of local agency. So I think looking to mediums like immersive theater and looking at just that SIGGRAPH this year, there was the winner of the real-time live competition was Unreal Engine being able to do live capture or something in mocap would be able to render it in real time and basically shoot a scene that they said it used to take 2 months and they did it live right there. So the tech and the tech stack is going to be able to have like Unreal Engine and do live improv actors and, you know, dealing with latency may be an issue, but in terms of the interaction, but having actors around the world distributed sort of acting in these type of live immersive theater type of experiences in VR, I think are going to be a huge component that are going to overcome the limitations of dealing with artificial intelligence interacting with NPCs and having actual live humans there interacting in these different bodies. I think is what I see is going to be a huge thing.
Hey, this is this is a big one, so maybe just give us a small piece of it. And Kent's usually the one asking this, but what do you see as the ultimate potential of VR, AR, MR?
I just firmly 100% believe that there's a huge shift in how we interact with technology coming. And I've just seen enough of it to feel like it's not even speculation. So to me, it's about thinking about how the major shifts in interacting with technology have affected us as a civilization, and how things have become, the world's gotten smaller and moved faster in a lot of ways, yet at the same time we've got a lot more empathy for each other and see a lot more perspectives easier and faster. So to me, I think getting rid of the screen is a huge evolution, and I think it's going to happen. For better or for worse. Like right now, I mean, I talk about, I want us to get rid of screens, and I just think it would be better, but the one good thing about the screens, you can always turn it off or walk away from it. And so it just depends on on how we as a society, like, you know, that's why I like to build the laws of mixturality, like how we take an opportunity to make society better and not just try to capitalize on, you know, what you know, let's just take this cool tech and make more money like we always have. Like, what are the fundamental powerful ways we can do it? So I think the sci-fi movie world is, you know, I don't think that's too crazy. But I just think that, you know, for the past 20 years, like one thing that's made me a professional in working with technology is because I'm okay with working with it and understanding how to, you know, logically deduce and debug and all these things. And I think pretty soon you'll be able to interact with technology without having to have these like this whole skill set of like interacting with operating systems and input. And so, I always brag about my Google Foo, right? Like I can find anything like in a couple searches. And, like, but the if you remove like my mother to have that ability to drill into that knowledge base by just asking a simple question or pointing at a thing and saying, "What is that?" And like, you know, I can do it right now, my ability with my mobile phone and my ability to search. But if you can basically bridge that gap between interaction and engagement and technology, it's super powerful, but for better or for worse, I'm not one to say.
Yeah, so, well, for anyone who's listening to the Voices of VR, you know that I ask everybody this question. So I could talk for literally hours about this, but I think in brief, you know, this, when I went to the Silicon Valley Virtual Reality Conference and I gave a talk trying to summarize 400 talks, it's episode 355, and that's where I came up with this, the landscape of all the different domains that you've experienced that VR is going to have. So you're really seeing that every different dimension of our lives that VR has some way that can add a change. And I think that the crux of it is that it's a new communication medium that is going to unlock latent human potentials in us and the way that we communicate and relate to each other. And that, just like Lawnmower Man, you know, he's going in and the neuroplasticity of the brain needs to unlock new capabilities that we don't even know that we have yet. And I think that is what gets me really excited. But I think that there's also another threat where people that go into VR and they do enough of it, they start to realize how amazing life is and how amazing reality is. And that you actually gain a deeper appreciation for a relationship to other people, but also the relationship to the earth and to the larger cosmos. And so I think that it has a capability to kind of get us out of this Facebook type of addiction, disassociation type of, like, you're just chasing the next high, but actually you can feel connected. The reason why I'm so interested in VR and artificial intelligence and other esoteric traditions is that it's all kind of like reflections of our humanity in a lot of different ways. The more that I learn about VR, the more I learn about being human, the more I learn about AI, the more I learn about being human. So part of why I have such an insatiable curiosity about this is because there's just so many different ways we're able to really learn stuff about ourselves. But I think that there's actually, if you look back into history, and you trace back to the Gutenberg press, you can put that as an original, like an origin point, as like a catalyst to the Renaissance. And I think that a similar type of starting point is the consumer computer. So the computer represents this new Gutenberg press that's enabling all these different new abilities in terms of how it's connecting our brains, how it's connecting us to each other, with the internet, how it's giving us these new immersive experiential technologies that are able to replicate reality in a way that's tricking our subconscious mind. So just like books were able to capture information and knowledge in a way that spurred the Renaissance, I think that VR represents a technology that can capture human experience. And from that, that's a new communication medium and a storytelling medium that I think, in the end, is going to kind of have this flourishing of human creativity, imagination, and connection.
Can you expand on the magically hardware at all and how it would compare to like the experience at HoloLens?
So I'm still under NDA. No, I mean, I think the high level, you know, in my presentation, that kind of high level experience, you can get that with HoloLens as well. The HoloLens has a fixed focal distance, so if you're aware of what that distance is, sort of play around with this kind of concept. So if I put virtual content, if I understand that the depth and the distance are kind of match up, play around with that. I just have to kind of mentally think about, publicly, recently, they've talked about it being a pair of glasses and a more general purpose computing device and more standalone. And I think, ultimately their core feature is understanding and respecting this kind of natural way we process the real world and respecting that. So fundamentally, that's always what the focus will be, but it is not for a particular type of experience. So it's about that.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right, I validate the limitations that keep you from getting back something if you're sat here for your text conference and so forth. And what are you reading before that's not a problem?
So I think on the VR side, that was an issue like a couple years ago, right? So I didn't get into it in my presentation, talking about the vestibular mismatch. So basically having the center here, and you're rendering all the photons that the eyes can currently see, and the scene updating fast enough to match with how fast you know you're moving your body, right? And if those don't reasonably match up, you start to get nausea or seasickness. There's a few tricks for that, technically speaking, like, some of it is frame rate, but then there's also what they call reprojection, where they'll actually, we make a ton of subtle head movements constantly, and so they'll actually, instead of having to re-render the whole scene just because I moved my head a little bit, or the fact that my head moved a little bit in the time that they rendered this frame, they're going to render the next frame, there's some tricks to cover that up. So from a performance perspective, it's still a pretty high-end PC you have to have on the VR side. But the burden is still there to update as fast as possible, so you have this seamless, it helps create presence, I think. Then on the AR side, you have less of the nausea issue because you still have the real world as your ground truth, and so the real world is still updating, fortunately, as fast as you expect it to. But it's more of an issue of a quality of experience, where if you're not updating fast enough the content, if you're locking an object in the real world, and it's not updating fast enough, it'll swim or wiggle or wobble, and it'll break that sense of presence and location. So there's still performance demands on the AR side, but it's more about quality of experience over comfort. I think a lot of the AR devices are, you can probably get around, HoloLens is all completely self-contained compute, right? That's a mobile compute stack. It's not a full PC GPU, but it's a very sparse experience, and it's not very detailed in terms of graphic fidelity. So there's trade-offs there. It depends on the mobile. My iPhone is as powerful as the game consoles I used to make games for, right? But eventually we're about to bump into that physical limit. So it depends on the platform. And I don't know that you'll always get this photorealistic experience on a mobile device. So you've got to tailor the experience for the device that's being consumed on. So,
yeah, I have a few thoughts. First, I'm going to say that it's difficult with VR to isolate things to one number and say this is the most crucial thing to hit this specific frame rate, because it really, frame rate isn't necessarily a bottleneck for what's going to create the VR experience. Frame rates are fine. The only thing is you just have to optimize the experience to be able to be efficient enough so that there's not too much polygon count, and if you have to deal with mobile, there's other considerations. But just to kind of take a step back and say the other dimensions are create presence, I'd say that, yeah, sure, visuals are great, but striving towards photorealism without paying attention to the sound or haptics or dimensions are not going to create the building VR experience. It also kind of depends on what you're trying to do. If you are trying to do that photorealism, then I think that one of the technologies that I see that's really coming out, that's really the cutting edge in terms of achieving physically based rendering that looks realistic, are these digital light fields. So Otoy, I think, is probably one of the leaders in that realm in terms of coming up with both. So digital light fields, you essentially are taking some sort of representation of the light waves that are floating
and see, you do that by sampling around, or it's basically a hugely data-intensive type of process. And the challenge is being able to render it, do it efficiently and quickly. And so when going to graph, I'd say that the digital light field technologies are kind of like at the cutting edge in terms of how do you get the data, how do you process it. You know, NVIDIA has their process where they're like, okay, well, we'll just throw a lot of GPUs at it. Other toys, like, oh, we're going to come up with a really specific algorithm to be able to make it really efficient and basically stream it down over the cloud. And so to be able to actually deliver digital light fields into your VR is something that they're showing. So you're able to get something that is way beyond what interactive VR experience could actually realistically render, but they're doing a lot of backend work in order to actually stream that down in a very efficient format. So digital light fields, I think, are kind of at the cutting edge in terms of how to actually create that photorealism. And that's what I see is kind of like how to deal with data. Because at NVIDIA's like demo of their libraries, I was sitting there with the headcam on display on for like 10 minutes because it like was processing in library before it could actually display it. It's like, my God, this is like terrible. Like no one's going to want to do that. So OTOIS really, I think, on the cutting edge is that. But I think that's probably where a lot of people focus on photorealism and they're going towards. But it's again, I think photorealism is something that a lot of people think they want, but they don't actually want. If you want to actually create something that's going to create a coherent and plausible experience, because as soon as you go to photorealism, then how are you going to do photorealistic touch? You can't do it. How are you going to do photorealistic sound? It's going to be kind of like not totally believable either. So I think if you dial down the fidelity and not strive towards that, then you can actually create a more compelling experience that has a deeper sense of immersion and presence.
How do they work differently for these new things, and what are the unexpected issues? So I work with a lot of video game artists, so they're already kind of conditioned to work with, you know, embedded systems and resource constraints and performance constraints. That part was not that big of an issue. That is a, you know, still a constraint to work within. I think it depends on the system you're working with. If you're talking about an optical view through and the mixed reality stuff that I was talking about, you've got to consider that just by virtue of the fact of how these systems work, they're an additive light field. So you're seeing the real world, you know, through some optics, and then this light is getting added to it. It's the same as if you put an additive filter on like a piece of art. So, you know, you can only be as bright as the content you're overlaying before you're struggling about trying to be as bright as like the sun, and then. And you have real problems with the sun. But so some of it is a little bit like color theory and a little bit of understanding this idea of perception. There's a lot of happy accidents, but it's not always bad. I didn't really get into it, but there's a lot of details that we fill in kind of our day to day, and it's based off prior knowledge, and it's based off you know, or recent knowledge and things. You can kind of play with that a little bit. So you actually don't have to get bogged down in photorealism in some cases or worry about details. A real high-level example is like if you have a character and maybe has these big glassy eyes with an environment map in it where it looks like it's reflecting the environment. People that are looking at that virtual content and all the things you're checking out perception-wise, they'll assume that reflection is this room. And like, you know, I've literally seen, we've had a fully baked out environment and I'm in someone's eye, like in a creature's eyes, and it's like of some random living room. And the person's viewing it in a totally different room. They're like, oh my God, I can see the reflection of this room in that character's eyes. And we don't tell them, but I mean, it's like, actually, you're seeing a reflection. And so there's a lot of cool, happy accidents that happen. That's why I'm so excited about this ability, because it taps into those things. And then, you know, I didn't work directly on the art side, but, you know, there are issues with understanding a little bit more detail on what I said about magical moments versus magical worlds. Field of view is a limitation on any
these current generation devices. So you're not going to reskin this entire like environment, but you're only going to see it in like a window, you know, a little magical window, and you're going to see the clean world outside of it. So you're better off having sparse content that can be easily framed within the field of view. So I would say that, and then, you know, there's a few other cool tricks that I'm not sure I've thought about that benefit from it, but I would say that I work with a lot of video game people that came from video game workflow, which, so if you were coming from like a more feature film background, you're first going to run into the same issues of like resource constraints and frame rate and things like that. But in general, if you've worked in real-time 3D or video games at all, it's like, right now, you can work with all this stuff right now. It's just that learning curve is so steep.
Yeah, I'd say so. The biggest thing is going from 2D to 3D. So if you're a 2D artist, then how do you work with these 2D tools? And I think that there's a level of abstraction that you have to do to use these 2D tools to do 3D. And I'm seeing these tools like Tiltbrush and Oculus Medium and Oculus Quill, where you're actually in 3D and making 3D art. So I think that people who are traditional 2D artists will start to learn how to make 3D within 3D. And I think ultimately that's where things will go for some people. I think that there's a level of efficiency that you have with your fingers that you don't necessarily have the same precision with your hand, for example. So I think that there's still a place for using some of these 2D tools, even though they're really a big pain. But yet, for some certain use cases, it's going to be way more efficient and better to still use the existing workflow pipeline. In fact, when I was at SIGGRAPH and talking to one of the founders and creators of Blender, he was pretty skeptical about. Like, he's like, yeah, you know, I've been in SIGGRAPH for many years, and people always try to do the 3D interface, and it's just sort of like never takes off. But I think there's something fundamentally different about the other. And I, the other thing is, that I'd say is that when you're creating something, you really have to see it in 3D in order to really get it. So there's like this iteration that needs to happen for people, even if you're doing it outside of VR. You actually put on the headset, and there's a completely different experience in VR that you see things differently, things bigger, smaller, the way it's positioned, and everything. That's like, for me, that's one of the biggest things that you can't necessarily like imagine, like looking at something on a 2D screen and be like, oh yeah, it's going to definitely be like this. So you kind of have to like put the headset on, take it off, put it on, take it off. And so that's a thing. But I think that's what may be moving people more towards doing things in 3D. But the thing that I'd say is, it's kind of applied it, but there's a difference between doing stuff with a 6-degree interface for 6 to 8 hours a day versus something that's at a kind of abstracted that's like more comfortable. So it's a more fatiguing interface to actually draw on 2D. So how sustainable, how long can you do that? Right? So you have to ask like, what are the things that you want to do in like just the regular 2D and then jumping in. And that. So I can kind of imagine people doing a little bit back and forth. But there's also the question of like how optimized is something going to be if you draw it in 3D and export it, right? So you may draw it, you get the idea that it's like brainstorming, but then maybe you have to go create from scratch and create it so it's optimized with the most, you know, minimal amount of polygons and whatnot. So I think those are a lot of different considerations that I see in terms of like making art of 3D.
One more question, please.
Okay, I just want to add, reminded me. So the biggest challenge I saw when we bring in third party people to work with like the tech directly is unit scale. So normally when you're working in 3D and like in a video game, you kind of arbitrarily say one unit is equal to 1 meter or one unit is equal to 1 centimeter for the purpose of this totally synthetic world. But when you're modeling something for the real world, people are kind of shocked that like we've never had any 4-set consistency before. So somebody will make something and they'll be like, this is going to be 2 stories tall, and it winds up being like this little 6-inch guy on the table. So when you're comparing against the real world, like the scale, and then the other thing before I forget, beyond that focal stuff I talked about, that's only good for a certain amount of distance. At a certain point, your eyes go parallel. And so then your basis for depth perception is a relative comparison. So you kind of, like, I roughly know this is this far away, and I roughly know that's that far away. But light, shadow, and occlusion are huge indicators. So if I'm putting a giant like monster, you know, 100 yards away, my basis for depth perception and realizing that that's a monster 100 yards away and not like a 1 foot monster right here is because of it being occluded by things in the distance or things casting shadow. So
a strong bind around environmental lighting and like how we perceive those things in those distances is huge. So that was another point we ran into. One more? Yes.
I wonder if you think about VR as a participatory tool, because VR is more focusing on this current experience. You get some kind of thing out, but other people cannot even understand what you're saying. So what do you think we need to think about when we want to connect people with this VR way?
So yeah, the question is essentially like, how do you connect with one VR that's kind of isolating, and where the sort of design principles in some sense of kind of make it a more participatory process. So I think that not all VR experiences are going to be participatory. It's just not going to work for every use case. I think, you know, when I do the conceptualization of the 12 domains of human experience, I kind of have like a theory that the more of those different domains that you incorporate, the more successful and more like real life will be, like the metaverse will be like that, and it will be inclusive of all the different domains of human experience, but yet some experiences won't be social, it will just be something that is private or something that you're doing on your own. And so I think that design for social collaboration at this point, I think that it's generally a good idea, but it's also like you create it and then how do you, it's like build it before they come. And you build like a bar and there's nobody there. So it's like supposed to be social, but there's not actually people there. I think the early days of social VR, they had, you know, at the max, like maybe 20 or 40 people at an event at any one given time. And it's still like the biggest VR events and consumer VR, you know, Second Life is another issue and had a lot larger history than that. But in terms of like the consumer VR, people in virtual reality headset, fully immersed, like maybe just a few hundred people that's in there at the same time. But having ways of, I think it's, right now there's been a lot of like social participatory games, like the most social things are like playing Upper Jumpers or Raw Data or Pool Nation or AllSpace VR is like a social app, right? So these are kind of places that they have a system for making it collaborative. But I think that overall there's going to be a whole domain of communication and telepresence tools that are really making, there's a lot of things that are missing right now, that I said. We don't have like good eye tracking built into the headset. SMI was releasing some stuff at SIGGRAPH, it's gonna be there, but in order to actually tell what people are looking at, that's a huge thing. Facial tracking, so be able to actually take your face and what you're expressing emotionally and putting it into VR. Right now, you get occlusion, so a lot of the facial detection algorithms don't really work all that well, so you have to do a lot of kind of extrapolation from regression databases and kind of prediction and stress sensors within the headset. So a lot of that technology isn't there yet. And I think that if anyone is like really thinking about this, it's Oculus, because whatever they come up with the next generation, I think they're going to be finally tuned to coming up with all the things that you really need to have in social VR. Because to have like a compelling experience, you really need eye contact and facial expressions. And I think at some point, you kind of need your full body. So just doing stuff on the Xbox controller, I don't think it's going to be compelling enough to really allow people to express themselves in the ways that they want to be. So that, as well as having an ability to control your identity and your expression of your avatar, making that simple and easy and customizable so that you can go into VR and have an expression of your identity that is perhaps more in alignment with how you see yourself. And make the tools to do that now aren't there to be able to really customize it. And that all of that, I think, is
I just pictured like the political Facebook post is now a room that you're in, and it's like comments you're gonna look at. But so I would say AllSpace is probably like the most accessible kind of social VR experience you can have right now, where you can actually just talk to people as naturally as you would in a real room in a real environment. And then I have seen there's more collaborative and more productivity oriented stuff coming, and it is pretty powerful when you can just track people's hands. And you may not be able to get their eyes, but you can generally get where their head's pointing. And I've seen a couple people have a virtual meeting where you kind of draw on a fake whiteboard, and all these people are in their respective physical geographical locations, but they're sharing this virtual room together. And I think there's something powerful there. And
actually like all space, like I'm a total introvert, so like in all space I turn off my microphone and people walk up and talk to me and I'll just kind of but I like to like watch people and like watch people talk. And they did that big live event with Richard Miller and Richard Watts, yeah. And so I was like, and they're having technical glitches, so then you pop into a room and people are just kind of entertaining each other, and it'll be like 30 people, like it, just like in real life, probably those same 30 people are in the room. The one person that's kind of the center of attention goofing off would probably be the same person in real life doing that. And it's pretty powerful to like be in your living room in like a 3-meter square, but then feel like you're in this room with 30 other people, and hearing them talk, and the audio of it. We talk about like audio being a real strong reality cue, like having a sense of position and relative position. So I think all those things, I think the ingredients are there. And there are some people working on like classroom, like VR classrooms and kind of that type of thing. I think collaboration in these virtual environments is a no-brainer. I think this is definitely going to happen. It's happening already. So I think it's really powerful, actually. And then I actually talked about this. So I did one of Kent's podcasts a really long time ago, and I talked about this ability for us to share. When you're in an AR context, you're sharing this physical space, but you could have a third participant that's maybe in a virtual space. But as far as they're concerned, you're in their physical space. This is real weird mind trip around. Well, we're all very naturally talking about the same thing. Maybe we're working on a project together, and we're all looking at this thing. And I'm like, yeah, look at that right there. And even though I'm in Portland and somebody's in New York, they're following me, very naturally saying, like, yeah, we'll turn it around with this thing over here. So there's some super powerful stuff around collaboration. And kind of connecting with people and sharing physical and virtual spaces all at the same time. So I think we are being extremely social, maybe for worse in some cases. Like that's part of the discussion right now is these VR experiences. People, for better or for worse. So can you control that social interaction? How much do you want to be exposed to or not exposed to? That's kind of an interesting topic.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
So, if you haven't seen the cookie shop, it's in the open for another 30 minutes or so. You can take a peek. It's a bit more of an intimate space than this one, and so if you don't get a chance to actually put on some gear, please stay tuned to our social channels and see when some of the smaller opportunities for demos are. But I encourage you to head out there, grab a cookie while they last, and at least take a peek at the space if you don't actually get to try on any of the gear up there. So thanks again. Really appreciate you guys coming out tonight. And thanks. We'll see you next time.
Yeah. So,
It was like so insane. I was like, this is so true. And I was like, you never thought about it. Like, she went to me after. I know, but she's like, it's so fascinating.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, obviously, it's embarrassing.